So, good afternoon and welcome. Welcome to the Western Blot imaging seminar that we will have today. Today we will have a different topic. So the first topic we will discuss is about sensitivity. How sensitivity is important for Western Blot imaging. So sensitivity is a key feature that you require for chemiluminescence. And we will explain why you need it and what makes sensitivity and how to validate a good sensitivity. The second topic we will discuss is about quantifications. So when you do a Western blot, you want first to be able to detect your proteins, but also you want to quantify your proteins. And normalization is a key topic in order to go for the quantification of proteins. And then we will discuss about fluorescence. So as you know, there are different ways to do Western blot. One way is chemiluminescence. So this is a very common way. And another way is fluorescence. And we will discuss about the comparisons in between fluorescence Western blot and chemiluminescence Western blot. What is good for you? And what are the advantages and the disadvantages of every technique? So let's start first with the sensitivity topics. So Western blot is a very, very nice protocol which will help you in order to detect a specific proteins. So there are not so many ways to do it. And thanks to Western blot, you go from a long list of proteins to the detections very precisely of one specific protein. So Western blot is about confirmations. Do I have this protein or not in my samples? So why we do Western blot is not just to detect, so to know, to validate, and to identify your proteins. It's also about to have some information in regard of these proteins, in regards of these samples. For instance, some of the information are qualitative. These qualitative information are about the quantity of proteins we have in the samples. So for instance, the 3D view will help us in order to transform the 2D view in 3D and to see if we have large quantity of or low quantity of proteins. Another way to have information in regards of the proteins we detected, that's about the molecular weight. With the molecular weight, we can validate the fact that the proteins which is on the Western blot is a specific protein that we are looking for. So this means that from a Western blot, not only we are able to identify the proteins, but also we are able to characterize the proteins and also to know about the quantity of these proteins. You need sensitivity in order to be able to quantify and to detect. Sorry, I need some time because as you see, the presentation is in Japanese. So I have to switch to my English presentation so that I see what is on the slide. Sorry for that. So sensitivity is a key in regards of Western blot, because one of the big advantages of chemiluminescence Western blot is that we are able to detect a very, very, very small quantity of proteins. With chemiluminescence Western blot, we can detect quantity of proteins such as picograms levels and even sometimes with femtograms levels. So a so small quantity of proteins. That's what you could have on your blot, but is it what you could have on your image? And sensitivity in regards of Western blot imaging is about to have on your image what you have on your blot. So there are different factors in order to define what we mean by sensitivity. Of course, we need to detect the weakest part of proteins we have in the dilutions in the blood. But sensitivity is not just in order to be able to collect the light for the picograms levels. Sensitivity is also about to collect the light at the same time for the strong signals and for the weak signals without saturations. That's what we call dynamic. So what we need when we take a picture is to have the largest possible dynamic without saturations. So this means that we could have on the same pictures a large quantity of proteins without saturation, and at the same time a very weak quantity of proteins able to be detected and able to be quantified. So this refers to the dynamic. And of course, in addition to this dynamic, which characterizes the sensitivity, is the possibility to have a linear approach. So for instance, we could try with some software manipulations to be able to see the lowest quantity and the largest quantity, but to lose the linearity in between the signals. Sensitivity is key in order to detect the lowest signals, to have a large dynamic, but also to have a linearity in between the different results. So that's the different factors that you need to take into account in order to define the sensitivity. So why sensitivity is so important? Sensitivity is important because when you make a blot, you don't want to have an image of the blot which said to you, maybe. You could not have this. When you make a blot, you have your proteins, your protein of interest, and when you take an image, you want to be totally confident that what you have on your image is what you have on your blot. If there is a gap, then you have a guess, and this guess will make sure that you could not be sure about what you see. When you take an image, you need to be totally confident with the image you have. So you could not have a guess approach. In order to do so, you need to have extremely high sensitivity. Extremely high sensitivity means that you will feel totally comfortable that the images you have take into account the lowest quantity of proteins you have. You have it on the image, you have the proteins. You should not ask yourself the questions, yes, but my protein quantity is not on the image. Is it because I don't have it? Or is it because the imager has some constraint? So certitude is what you need to get from the sensitivity of an image. When you do a Western blot, you understand that the Western blot protocol is very, very difficult to manipulate. So it's a very long protocol, it's a long process, and at every stage of the Western blot process, mistakes will occur. And in order to make sure that every time you do a Western blot, you have a nice Western blot output, a nice Western blot image, you need to do a lot of optimization in your process. So there is not only a learning curve from the way to do the Western blot, but also you can optimize your Western blot by optimizing, for instance, the substrate, so like the ECL, or by optimizing the primary antibody. There are many, many substrates on the market. Some of the substrates are weak, some of the substrates are very strong. The strong substrates are very expensive, and the weak ones are very cheap. If you have sensitivity, you don't have to go for only very expensive substrates. You can go for cheaper substrate in order, and the imagers will compensate with the longer exposure times. Another thing that you can do with your imagers is to optimize the concentration of the primary antibody. So, in this example, so we had some blood with a different concentration of primary and secondary antibody. Primary antibody could be very, very expensive, and also you could not maybe sometimes have it in a very, very strong quantity. So it could be very interesting to reduce the quantity of the primary antibody. If you have an imager with a large, large sensitivity, then it's very easy to optimize your protocols, to optimize your quantity of primary antibody, thanks to the imager systems. The imager systems will compensate the quantity you reduce of primary antibody by increasing the exposure times. when you increase the exposure times, you get more signals, and so you can detect your proteins while you have reduced the primary antibody. This optimization process is very important, and you need to rely on your imagers in order to be able to do it. So what is sensitivity? Sensitivity is not just what you see. Sensitivity is about the data, the information you have in your blood. So when you are able to detect the proteins, then you are very happy because you think that, yes, I saw my proteins. But the question you should ask yourself is that, do I have enough information coming from these proteins? Am I able to quantify these proteins? So that's what we call the limit of quantifications. The limit of quantification is the limit for which you have enough data in order to quantify the protein. On the opposite, we have the limit of detection. The limit of detection is what you can see. So what you can see sometimes is very fair, but what you can see sometimes you could not quantify it because you don't have enough information, you don't have enough data in order to quantify. So let's have a look on the illustrations to explain the meaning of this. Here we have been able to detect these proteins. So we have, in terms of limit of detection, we have been able to detect the proteins. However, if we look at the 3D view, so at the volumes coming from these proteins, we can see that the volume is very, very, very small. The volume is within the noise from the blood. So the limit of quantification for this protein is very strict, and maybe we will not be able to use it in order to do the quantification. So we could detect it, but we will not be able to quantify it. So sensitivity is not just about to detect, to see, but it's also about to have enough information to go for quantification. So, there are different factors to take into account in order to define the sensitivity. One of the factors is the capabilities to detect the proteins. So, am I able to identify the proteins am I supposed to have in my samples? This is measurable in terms of picograms levels or in terms of femtograms levels with chemiluminescence. Another factor to take into account is a background. If we have a large background coming from the blood, or if we have a large background coming from the imagers, we will not be able to detect the protein, because the background levels will be higher compared to the light coming from the protein. Another thing to take into account is the signals to noise. If the noise is high, but the level of light coming from the protein is low, still, we will not be able to reach the limit of quantifications. So we need to have a very high ratio of signals to noise in order to be able to see properly, with confidence, the protein. In these examples, we can see that we have been able to detect the proteins because we have decreased the noise from the systems and from the blood to the minimum. If we would have a higher noise, we would not have been able to detect the protein. So this means that when you have an image, you have to be very careful, because we are always able to optimize the display of the image so that you can see your proteins in a nice way. However, when you look at the profiles or at the quantitative data coming from these proteins, from the volumes of the proteins, you can see that in one case we have a large quantity of data so that we have been able to detect and we have information. On the other case, we have a very weak signal, but the display has been optimized. So We feel comfortable with the image, but we should not, because if we look at the profile, we can see that we are not able to have any kind of data, any kind of information coming from this image. Detections, informations, detections, optimization of the image display. However, there is nothing we can do about this image. We don't have the linearity, and we cannot reach the limit of quantification. So what are the factors which will make the sensitivity? So this is a topic I know very, very well, because I have been designing imaging systems for Western blot for the last 15 years. So there are some key factors such as the camera and of course the optics, but there are some other factors which will make a big difference in regards to the sensitivity. For example, the distance in between the samples and the lens. If the distance in between the Western blot and the camera is very high, then the light has difficulties to reach the imager. So the distance has always to be as short as possible. If you have a mirror inside the machine, you will increase the distance. If you increase the distance, then you lose in terms of sensitivity. And also you will get some distortions. Another factor is to keep the systems totally light-proof. So why the systems need to be totally light-proof? Because you need to reduce any kind of backgrounds inside the dark rooms. If your system is not totally light-proof, then unfortunately some lights will get inside, not too much, but it will increase the background on your image. The lens also, it's a very, very key, and we need to have extremely high sensitivity in regards of the lens, but also we need to have a lens able to work at a short distance. Some lens are very sensitive, but they can work only at a long distance, and so we have to compensate these problems using some additional lens or some software manipulations, and this will damage your image. So the lens also is. And the last factor, which is totally determining for the Western blot images, that's the cooling of the camera. Some images are, you need exposure times in order to take your image. Exposure times means that you will collect the light for some times. If you collect the light for some times, unfortunately, you will also collect the energy inside the atmosphere, and this will create some noise in your image. In order to make sure that you do not collect this energy, you need to cool the camera. This will give you some confidence. If you have a very, very important cooling, then you are able to have very, very long exposure times, like few minutes. If the cooling of the camera is inconsistent and too low, unfortunately, the exposure times could not move very, very far. So just few seconds. The other things which will be interesting to take into account when you go for sensitivity, when you go for imagers for Western blot, is that in your laboratories, when you do Western blot, in most of the cases, some team of your laboratories or even yourself, you are doing some other applications which require a lot of sensitivity. We have many, many customers doing, for instance, a northern blot or southern blot, and these people, they are used to have exposure times on the film for an overnight, for a full night. So 12 hours exposure times on the film. Thanks to the imaging system, so you can reduce this overnight exposures from 12 hours to just 1 hour. So it's a lot of difference. In one case, you make one sample every 2 days. With an imager, you could have many samples just per day. Some other exciting applications in regards of with imagers with a very, very large sensitivity, that all the applications which need bioluminescence. So this means in vivo applications, so for the mouse, but also on the plants. That's many things that you can do. Also, if you have macro titrations with bioluminescence or with luminescence, that also could be used in a system which has a very, very, very high sensitivity. Auto-exposure is key. So when you have the chemiluminescence Western blot, the light coming from the blot is not stable. As soon as you have add your substrate to the blot, the light will start, and then the light intensity will increase, then reach a plateau, and then it will decrease slowly. This kinetic reaction could last for a few minutes, or a few hours, or a few seconds, and this is unknown. This is unknown because this will depend on different factors, such as the pH on the Western blot, and also the quantity of secondary antibody. So in order to compensate from this light, which is totally unstable, we have a feature which is called the auto-exposures. The auto-exposures is a very, very nice feature because first, it's very simple to use. You just have to click on one button, and then automatically, the systems will calculate the optimum exposure times in order to take your image. These exposure times, when you have a blot and you put it inside the machines, you don't know it. So when you want to take an image, you don't know how much time you need in order to take the image. The auto-exposures will work in the way that it will first take a sample image, and from this sample image, it will calculate the optimum exposure times for you to take an image. So it's nice, you just click on one button, you don't need to know the exposure times, and the system by itself will calculate the exposure times. But there are some other advantages to the auto-exposures, is that it will compensate from the kinetic of the light coming from the samples. So this means that it will give you some repetitivity in when you take an image. So here we see the curves of the intensity of the light coming from the Western blot with a certain substrate, and we see the intensity compared to the time. With the auto-exposures, when we have a large light, the auto-exposures will calculate itself a short exposure times in order to get a picture. And when the light coming from the ECL will decrease, the auto-exposures will automatically calculate a larger exposure times. So the advantage of this is that whatever the signal substrate is in its time period, in its kinetic way, the auto-exposures will always try to take the best image. The best image is defined in regards of the dynamic we have on the image. But you can decide by yourself with the software if you want to have the systems which calculate the auto-exposures based on the weakest signals or on the larger signals or on a specific part of your blood. Vision. Yes. So one of the big factors to take into account when you have a Western blot imaging, that's the background levels you have from these systems. So already when you do your blot, there are many factors which will increase the backgrounds when you take an image. So according to the membranes you have, PVDF or nitrocellulose, you could have a large background or a smaller background. The way you wash your proteins also make a difference. The secondary antibody you use also make a difference in terms of backgrounds. But if in addition to that, the imagers make a large background, then your level of detection of your proteins will not be that good. So the background level is a very, very key factor to take into account. So here we have an illustration which explains that. So in this case, with the systems, we have been able to detect a low quantity of proteins at the picograms levels, and that's what we expect. And we have here a very low background, and that's also what we want. We want to have a low background so that we are able to detect every kind of signals which is above the background. Also, this will help in order to have a lot of quantification data. It will increase the image dynamic, and it gives more chance to have a linearity of measurements in the signals. If you have a larger background, then it's a big problem because you cannot detect the signals which is below the background. So if your background level is there, and if your signal level is there, then you will not see it on your image. If you increase the exposure times, you will increase the backgrounds and the signals, but still you cannot see it. So the background level is something to take into account, and it's a very, very important factor. In many cases, I see like blood, for which people, they just care about detections and they have short exposure times, like 5 seconds or 10 seconds, and they see like a very, very strong proteins. And so, when they do this, people do not feel that the systems could produce a background, because they're just a small exposure times. But when you have like 3 minute exposure times, 5 or 10 minutes exposure times, or like you have different applications like a southern blot or northern blot, then the backgrounds will increase dramatically. And then what you feel, which was good for just few seconds exposure times, you realize that it's a disaster for longer exposure times. So when you have a system coming to your lab, what are the different factors that you need to consider? First of all, you need to make your own samples. You cannot validate the systems using the samples that imager companies provide to you. If I had to give you samples in order to test the machines, of course I will always give you a nice samples. But in your lab, you don't always have a nice samples. So you need to consider the different samples that you produce yourself. If you had a chance to produce your own Western blot for the validation of the systems, we suggest to make a dilution. The dilution is key because it will give you the opportunities to see what are the limits of detection of the systems. Is the system having a large dynamic? Is the system having the possibility to detect picograms level of proteins? That will give you some information. Another way is to change the different primary antibodies. So if you could prepare different samples, it's even better, because then you can see different primary antibodies, so different proteins at different quantities and different detection levels. Make sure that what you see from the imagers give you some information. If you just see the image and if you don't go for the quantifications, the mistake is that all the systems, they have some optimization of image display, and the optimization of image display is a disaster because you feel that it's nice but it's not so nice. So this is why you need to ask the people to provide you the demo image in a TIFF format. So the TIFF format is a scientific format which contains all the information, all the data coming from the image in 16 bits. This image, we suggest that you open it in a different software such as Photoshop or Imagy, so that you can validate that what you have seen from the imagers is totally correct when you look at it inside a different software independent from the system. Then when you open the image in Imagy or Photoshop, you need to validate the linearity of the data you have. If you have prepared a dilution, that's something which is very, very simple to do and just take few seconds. How to evaluate, what are the criteria, what are the factors which make a difference in terms of systems, in terms of imaging? So the first one is the sensitivity. So that's what you can see with, if you prepare a dilution. So this system has been able to see this limit of detections. What about these other systems with the same dilutions? So that at that time, you are able to compare different systems with the same criteria. Another factor is the resolutions. So some systems which has low sensitivity compensate the lower sensitivity by reducing the resolutions. So you have a very, very small and tiny image, and a small image at the end, that's not what you want. You have prepared a lot, it took a lot of time. At the end, you want to have a large image so that you want to see this image in a nice way. If you have a small image, be careful, because maybe this image will not be accepted for publications. Another factor to take into account is a dynamic range. So that's what we have discussed before. What is important is not only to be able to detect the weakest protein, but what is important is also to be able to detect the biggest protein at the same time in the same blood without saturation. Another thing which is of course very important is that you will use the machines yourself, so you need to have a system which is very, very easy to use, very self-understandable. Last but not least, you need to have an imaging system which is able to cover different kinds of applications. Applications like chemiluminescence, but also maybe if you have gels, the possibility to take the image from the gels, or to take the image from protein gels, also. So that's why you need to know what kind of applications you need to image in your laboratories, maybe not just you, but also in your groups or in the different groups which share the system. In our case, we do imaging systems. So we have been very, very well known in the imaging market for the last decades. So I think we started in 1980, so long time. We have been in Japan with MAS for the last maybe 30 years.
27 years.
So it's a long relationship and a long-term relationship. Which is the key process in order to go for quantification. So when we make a Western blot, the first thing we want to know is that do we have the proteins inside this Western blot? So are we able to detect the protein? One of the things we want to know is that, okay, we have been able to detect the proteins, but can we be confident that the proteins we have detected is the appropriate one? Is why we have the molecular weight. Another thing that we can see from the Western blot image is that we can easily see the quantity difference in between the proteins. So in this case, for example, we have been able to detect two proteins. In one case, this protein is very strong. In the other case, the protein is weaker. So we can say that if the protein is strong, this means that the quantity of proteins bigger. So that's, let's say, the qualitative information that we have right away from a Western blot. Capacity to detect, roughly to adjust to see the quantity compared to another one, and also to characterize with the molecular one. But maybe we can go further, so we want to have some quantitative information coming from the Western blot. So the quantitative information are in regards to the quantity we have for each single protein, and this quantity could be either calculated in a relative way or in an absolute way. This is done by taking into consideration the intensity we see on the image, so the intensity levels pixels per pixels in an area, and this intensity in this area give a volume, and this volume is the quantity of proteins we have. So if we are able to measure these volumes, then we have a quantity. So to do a Western blot takes a lot of time. There are many steps in order to do the Western blot, and these physical steps makes of course create some limitation inside the Western blot. Some of the limitations we have when we do a Western blot could be like, for instance, the palpating mistakes that we can do. But also when we do the transfer in between the gels and the blot, maybe some information has been lost in the transfer. So there are many factors which make sure that the output we have, the image we have, maybe made some troubles because of what we have done before. So if we are able to compare what we have done with some things which always behave in a nice way, then we can have more confidence in our blot. And that's what we call the normalization. So the normalization is the use of housekeeping proteins inside the blot that we will compare with our protein of interest in order to normalize, to validate that what has been done before is totally correct. There are different ways to do the normalizations. So a very straightforward way, a very, let's say, traditional way, that's single protein normalizations or inline normalizations. So inline normalizations take into consideration the housekeeping proteins. These housekeeping proteins will be compared with a protein of interest so that we have the normalizations like that in between two proteins in the same length. And then we have the total protein normalizations. In the total protein of normalizations, we will compare not just one protein with another, but the total quantity of proteins we have in our samples with our protein of interest. So that's the total protein normalization. So two different ways to do the normalization. If we look at the single protein normalization or inline protein normalizations, the process is very straightforward, very basic. So we have the protein of interest, we have the housekeeping proteins, and this housekeeping protein is now compared in terms of quantity with our protein of interest. So we obtain the ratio. As the housekeeping proteins always behave in the same way, then we are supposed to have a linear ratio if we compare the different normalized data between the different lengths. So that's very straightforward, but just that there is one problem, is that if we want to compare the protein of interest with the housekeeping protein, we should have it in the same blood. And with scaling reasons, to have the two proteins in the same blood is quite a long process and quite difficult. So, in many cases, what people do is that they do their own blood with their protein of interest, then they do a second blood, and then on the same image, they take the two blots and they try to adjust like that. Another way is to wash your blot and to reprobe and restrict your blot with your housekeeping proteins. But the problem is that when you do this, of course, you lose some information because the blot washing wash maybe too much your blood. So the single protein normalization is a very common approach, and I would say that maybe 80% of the people who go for normalizations, they go for inline normalizations. But still, you have to be careful if you go in that direction. You need to make sure that the molecular weight from your housekeeping protein is a substantially different compared to the molecular weight coming from your protein of interest. If not, as you can see in the pictures, it will be too close from each other, and then it will be you will not be able to do the comparisons in an appropriate way. Another factor to take into account when you select your housekeeping protein, that's the quantity of these housekeeping proteins. If you have too much or too big difference in between the quantity of your protein of interest and your housekeeping protein, then you will have on your image one of the proteins which will be extremely expressed, so this means almost reaching the saturation, and unfortunately the other proteins which will be very difficult to detect. So you need to make sure that in terms of signal intensity, the two proteins express in the same way. So the limitations for the inline normalization is that when you go for chemiluminescence, you can have only one antibody. That's very a limitation of the nature. One antibody means one protein, so it's very difficult to have two proteins at the same time on the same blood. If you want to have different proteins, you would need to go for blood washing. Blood washing is a disaster, it damages your blood, and you cannot be very confident with the data you have after the washing. There is one way in order to overcome these limitations, that's Western blot fluorescence. So we see more and more people going for Western blot fluorescence, because Western blot fluorescence has a lot of advantages for Western blot. So, in total protein normalizations, we will consider the total quantity of proteins we have per length, the quantity of protein of interest, and in the same way that we did the ratio with the inline normalizations, we will do the same ratio with the total protein normalizations. So instead of considering just two proteins, the housekeeping proteins, which was added to the samples, and also the protein of interest, we will consider only the proteins that we had originally in the samples, but all the proteins and all the quantity of proteins we had in the samples. So we can already see that we need different image to do that. We need first the image of the protein of interest, but also we need the image of with the complete data with all the proteins. In order to do so, you need to stain your gels. So in order to be able to see all the proteins, there are different ways to stain your gels. So one of the ways is to do it before the adding of the antibody. So it's very nice, but the detection level is quite poor. Another way is to do it after the antibody inside your samples. Then you will get more sensitivity. But also, it's in terms of protocol, it's not very convenient and simple. And then there are a third way, which is very easy to do, that's the stain-free. The stain-free provides you a lot of advantages. In terms of manipulations, it's very easy, so it's very practical. In terms of detection limits, that's probably what has the best detection limit. But it has some limitations. One of the limitations of the stain-free is that it's tryptophan dependent. So if you do not have tryptophan highly expressed in your proteins, or if you have no tryptophan inside your proteins, then the stain-free will not work. So this means that in terms of staining, there are different ways, and you could not just focus on just one way. You will probably have to focus on different ways according to the proteins you have. Here we can see in these samples the Comasi gels which has been made with proteins. The same proteins, the same gels with stain-free. We can see that according to the tryptophan inside the proteins, the bonds are there. So, what are the advantages of the total protein normalization? Now, first of all, the advantage is that it's much more accurate compared to the inline normalization. it doesn't mean that the inlet normalization is not accurate. It just means that more data we have, of course, more accuracy we have. However, it has a big limitation in that what I say is simply not totally correct, in a way that the quantification of all the proteins inside one single lens requires a lot of effort and, unfortunately, a lot of incertitudes. Why? Because in a gel there are many, many proteins, and to have the data from the complete samples is very, very difficult for the imaging systems and for the imaging software. So this means that in many cases, proteins are simply not taken into consideration in the analysis. So another disadvantage of the total protein normalizations is that you need to have different pictures, and these pictures are not taken in the same conditions. One picture could be like chemiluminescence, or one picture could be like fluorescence, and another one could be invisible. And the comparisons of the two pictures are very, very difficult. So the question is could be like, which normalization process is nice for my laboratories, for my samples? Well, it's difficult to say. The two approaches are very nice. In one way, we have like the inlet normalizations, a very fast and a quick way to do the normalizations and to validate the data we have. So it's very nice because it's fast. On the other way, with the total protein normalizations, it takes much more time, it takes much more effort from you, but at the end, it's much more accurate if you follow the process in a very accurate way. So we finish the discussions in regards of the normalizations. We have discussed about the housekeeping proteins and the inline normalizations. And also, we presented the total protein normalizations, and we compared the two approaches. Do you have any questions? Now we'll discuss about fluorescence, because we saw that normalization is nice. We saw that, yes, of course, probably like housekeeping proteins and inland normalization is much more easy and practical. However, to do it with chemiluminescence could be a little bit difficult. So there is another way to do Western blot, which is fluorescence. With fluorescence Western blot, we are able to detect different proteins at the same time, and that's what I will present to you now. So, when we go for chemiluminescence, we have one protein which could be detected thanks to one primary antibody. And we have one primary antibody because we are able to connect the secondary antibody and the enzyme to the primary antibody, and we just have one single enzyme. So one single enzyme, one single primary antibody. With a fluorescence approach, we don't have this enzyme situations. So we have also a primary antibody. So it works in the same way as a standard Western blot, chemiluminescence. However, you might have to optimize the quantity of primary antibody. Normally, for fluorescence, the quantity of primary antibodies tend to be a little bit bigger. Then we have a secondary antibody, and instead of having the connections in between the secondary antibody and the enzyme, we connect the secondary antibody with the dye. So the dyes could be like Cy2, Cy3, Cy5, or any kind of dyes on the market, if it makes sense. So if we have some dyes, then we could have different antibody, primary antibody. If we have different primary antibody, we are able to detect different protein at the same times, on the same experiment, on the same blood, but not on the same image because that's fluorescence. So there are some advantages in regards of fluorescence western blot. First of all, is that we don't have enzyme, we don't have substrate. So this means that the signal is very stable. We need to have some external light to excite the samples and to have some filters in order to see the light coming from a specific wavelength. But this has some advantages, such as when you finalize your western blot chemiluminescence blot, you cannot do anything with your blot. When you took your image, it goes to the garbage. When you go for fluorescence, you can keep your blot, and if you keep your blot in the appropriate way, the blot will emit the light for maybe 1 year. So you can keep the blot for a long, long time. If you keep the blot in the light. Another thing which is nice is that there are a lot of different dye on the market. And thanks to that, you could have visible dye, or you could have also IR dyes. So this means that you could have IR detections, which give you the opportunity to have very low backgrounds, fluorescence backgrounds, on your blood. So the detection is quite straightforward. However, the detection levels of fluorescence is not as good as the detection levels of chemiluminescence. So if you have like a low level of proteins, like picograms levels, then chemiluminescence is much more better. If you have a large quantity of proteins, then fluorescence is very convenient. So the advantage of chemiluminescence is that it's quite easy to do. You don't need much quantity of primary antibody. You could have a limit of detections like picograms or femtograms levels. Chemiluminescence is a very well-known technique in the laboratories, so you have this expertise already probably in your laboratories. And it's quite affordable. The disadvantage of chemiluminescence is that you will detect only one protein at a time. So that's the main disadvantage. The other limitation is that when your blood is finished, then no more light will come from the blood after just few minutes or few hours. So you cannot keep it. Another disadvantage is that if you go for normalizations, then you need to go for the washing of your blood. And the washing of your blood takes time, and also you damage your blood, and you are not very confident with the information you have after this process. If you go for fluorescence, it has also some advantages and some disadvantages. So the advantage of fluorescence is that you can detect different proteins at the same time. So you will have on the same blood your protein of interest, or two proteins of interest, and your housekeeping protein. You could have 4, 5, 6, but it doesn't make sense. After 3, you have some difficulties because you will have some crosstalks in between the dyes and you will not see much. So 3 proteins is nice, 2 is very common, 4, 5, not so good. The fluorescence gives you a lot of reproducibility. So if you have a certain amount of proteins, and if you give the same amount of light, then you have a linearity in between the light coming from your systems and the light coming from the protein. You modify the quantity of proteins, you modify your quantification. So it's very, very simple like that and reproducible. When you have a Western blot with chemiluminescence, it's much more difficult to reproduce exactly the same because the substrate will react with the secondary antibody and with the enzyme. If you modify just a little bit of quantity of secondary antibody, or just a little bit the quantity of the substrate, or you modify just the way you have put the substrate on the blood, and then you modify the data. So the reproducibility of chemiluminescence is not at the same level as the reproducibility of fluorescence. Another advantage of the protein is that of the fluorescence is that you don't need to ask yourself, should I go for inline normalization or should I go for total protein normalizations? In any case, you will have all the information in just one single samples. So you don't need to prepare many, many samples. All the information are inside the same samples. That's just that you will need to take different images and combine the image together in order to compare the information. For instance, if you have on the same blood one protein of interest and one housekeeping protein, then you take first the pictures with one dye, one filters, the pictures of the protein of interest, and then another pictures with another filters for the housekeeping protein. So what are the disadvantages of the fluorescence? First of all, the detection level is not as good as the detection levels coming from chemiluminescence. So many people, they say, no, that the same, we could detect in the same way. And unfortunately, no, it's not possible. Some publications say that the ratio of detections in between fluorescence and chemiluminescence is 10,000 times. 10,000 times, to be honest, is quite a lot. But yes, we speak about nanograms detection levels for fluorescence, and we speak about picograms detection levels for chemiluminescence. Another disadvantage is that you need to readapt the way you did your blood before, in a way that the quantity of primary and secondary antibody are not the same. So you need to have an optimization period, and an optimization in regards to the quantity of primary antibody, in order to have the same kind of output compared to chemiluminescence. In most of the cases, you need to increase the quantity of primary antibody if you go for fluorescence. Another thing to consider is that for fluorescence, suppose we have the dye, the fluorophores. If we have the dyes and the fluorophores, then there are many factors coming from fluorescence to take into consideration. One of the factors is that the light source you will need to have in the system in order to take an image. So which light source, how many light sources you need, should you have like a visible light source, like a green, blue, red, or should you have like IR light source, like NIR, IR, that need to be taken into consideration. Another thing to take into consideration is that the dye itself, so the dye, they have some crosstalk, so you need to make sure if you want to see two different proteins, but not to have any kind of crosstalks in between the dyes in your samples. If not, when you take the image of your protein of interest, at the same time you will see your housekeeping proteins, and so the quantifications will not be possible. So you need to make sure that you have a clear separation in terms of spectra in between the excitation light, the emission light from the dye A for the protein of interest and the emission light from the dye B for the housekeeping protein. So which method is good for you? You should not ask yourself, you should not be like a completely chemiluminescence oriented laboratory or a completely fluorescence-oriented laboratory. If you just go for fluorescence, the meaning of it is that it means that if you have low quantity of proteins, you cannot detect. If you go only for chemiluminescence, then the meaning of that is that you could not validate your output having a housekeeping protein on the same blood. Always you need to wash your blood, restrict, or separate into two. So you should not say to yourself, should I go for chemiluminescence or should I go for fluorescence? If you like fluorescence, you should be open to chemiluminescence. And if you like chemiluminescence, you should be open to fluorescence. So I know it's like a no fact. Yes, no fact. Sorry for that. Yes, we saw in the two slides that fluorescence and chemiluminescence has some advantages according to the protocol, according to the proteins you have, and according to what you want to see. So now, let's say, what kind of imaging systems would be appropriate for you? If chemiluminescence is your main application, what is really, really important for you, that's what we discussed in the first part of the presentation, that's sensitivity. Sensitivity is freedom. So sensitivity is freedom for you, because if you have sensitivity, you are able to go for quantifications, you are able to detect the proteins you have in your samples, you are able to be confident with what you see. This freedom, that's what you want. If you go for fluorescence, you go for fluorescence because you will be able to detect different proteins on the same blood. So that's key. In the future, so we can see that the number of publications with the fluorescence Western blot is fastly growing. So you cannot say, I will never go for fluorescence detections for Western blot, because it will come to you. Because people for publications will ask you to have more confirmation, so more normalizations. They will discuss the normalizations you do today with your housekeeping proteins. And so you will have, unfortunately, to go in that direction. But you have to be very careful, because if you go for fluorescence, you need to be very careful in regards of the excitation source. You could not just simply take a green light and put some green light on your blood and expect to see something. No, unfortunately, the light has to be very accurate according to your protein, same as what you will have in a microscope. You need to have a very specific light, you need to have some very specific emission filters, and these emission filters will make sure that what you see in your samples, that's your protein of interest, and not another protein which was not blocked properly or anything like that. So, today we have discussed about different topics. So the first topic was the sensitivity. Why is it so important for Western blot imaging? The second topics were in regards of the quantification of Western blot and how the normalizations help you for the quantification of Western blot. And then the third topic we have discussed is the fluorescence. The fluorescence is a new approach to Western blot. There is no fight in between fluorescence and chemiluminescence. The advantage of fluorescence is that you can detect different proteins at the same time. However, the disadvantage is that you do not reach the same level of detection compared to the fluorescence. So thank you for your time. If you have any questions, please feel free.